Welcome to Strike Fighters 2. This is episode 35 of my U.S. Navy playthrough. We're back today with the recently promoted Commander Devin Horner flying F-4 Phantoms off the USS Enterprise with VF-92, the Silver Kings. The date is April 17th, 1967. This is 8 days after our previous mission. In the real-life timeline of the Vietnam War, nothing particularly interesting going on this week other than Operation Rolling Thunder continues to strike at railroad and highways in an interdiction effort in North Vietnam, and also continues the strikes that began last week against power plants and industry in Hanoi itself. Our mission today is going to be to strike a strategic target located in Phu Tho. We are to destroy the enemy highway bridge in the target area. Phu Tho and this bridge are on the Red River to the west of Hanoi, so we'll actually be, and we'll see in the map in a second, we'll actually have to fly past Hanoi in order to get to the target today, so fairly deep into North Vietnam. Call sign will be Dallas. We'll be taking two F-4B Phantoms. Takeoff time at 6:49 a.m. Over the target by 7:08. Back to the boat by 7:39. Today here in Dallas 1, we're back in aircraft 100, which we've been flying almost exclusively during this campaign. USN Gray 1 paint scheme. 100% fuel. And our loadout is going to be 18 Mark 82 500-pound bombs, along with our air-to-air defense armament of 4 AIM-9 Sidewinders and 4 AIM-7 Sparrows, and 1 600-gallon drop tank on our center line. Total takeoff weight for both aircraft today is going to be 59,770 pounds each. Here to our map now. We'll be taking off from Yankee Station here in the Gulf of Tonkin, turning to the right to then circle around to the south, before heading north up to Waypoint 3 just south of Haiphong. After that, we'll make a left turn towards the Vietnamese coast, and then we'll go feet dry between the cities of Haiphong and Nam Dinh. Now, what comes next is going to be the really interesting part, because we're going to have to fly almost directly over Hanoi and Fukien Air Base up to the northwest, up to our initial point, Waypoint 4. Stationed at Fukien Air Base, we can see there are 3 squadrons of MiG-21 PFVs, most likely of the 921st Red Star Squadron, and a MiG-17 PF Fresco D Squadron. Up to the northwest, at Yen Bai Airfield, which is right next to our target area, we have another squadron of J-5 Frescos. So any of these squadrons could be coming into play today to try to intercept us. We'll be right over their backyards. In addition to that, of course, we'll have major threats from both SAMs and AAA on our way in and out of the target today. After we fly over Hanoi, we'll be taking the north or right side of the Tam Dao mountain range, also known as Thud Ridge. Once we clear Thud Ridge, we'll make that left turn down to the southwest and head toward our bridge target in Phu Tho across the Red River. After we strike the target in a dive bombing run, we'll egress down to the south to Waypoint 6, and then proceed southeast to head back towards the Vietnam coast to go feet wet just south of Tan Hoa and the Ma River. After that, it's back out to sea and then returning back to Yankee Station for landing back on the Enterprise. Additional squadrons that we'll see out in the air today, providing cover for us or striking other targets. We see Lion Flight, which is going to be 2 A6 intruders flying Iron Hand over Phu Tho, so they'll actually be our Iron Hand flight. They'll be suppressing, hopefully, suppressing anti-air defenses in our area. So maybe we'll see some these 2 intruders up the Kitty Hawk nearby. Mamba is a strike flight of 8 F-4 Phantoms off the USS Constellation. They'll be striking the Ha Dong Barracks. And keeping things busy in the air over Hanoi itself, we've got a couple of Marine squadrons that are going to be getting into the mix. Here we have VMFA 542 from Da Nang Air Base. This is Wolfpack flight. They'll be flying a strike into Hanoi, and they're 4 F-4 Phantoms. Additionally, we've got Tuna Flight, which is an escort flight of Marine Phantoms out of Chu Lai. They'll be heading into Hanoi as well, so there will be some fighter protection in the area, in addition to any other Navy escorts that might be out and about. And before we go, you can see off to the right there, known aces in the theater is Commander Devin Horner, me with 22 kills, and our good friend Ensign Walter Berzer with 5 kills, a recent ace from our own squadron. Now to the roster, Dallas 1 is going to be me. My wingman for this mission is going to be, once again, Ensign Keith Alvarez. In case you've missed it, Keith Alvarez is a recent replacement pilot to the squadron and came to us with 0 kills, no combat missions, and very low stats. So I've been taking note each mission to note how much he's improved in each stat from the previous mission. So we'll take him along today for his 3rd mission total and his first strike mission, first air-to-ground mission. His current skill is 31, which is up 1 point from 30 last mission. His experience is 15, it was 7, so he gained 8 experience from that last mission. Morale, 78, is up from 71, so he gained a bunch of morale. And his condition is now 61, down from 70, so he's becoming more fatigued as he's flying these missions, but his morale is going up. If you remember, last mission, he actually didn't fire any weapons, nor did he shoot anything down. So, just the experience gained from just flying a mission, a combat mission, into Vietnam and back, without actually even doing anything, he got the 1 skill point and the 8 experience, and his morale went up. So, interesting to note that. Even if the wingmen are not actively doing something, they're still gaining experience every time they go out. So, good to know. His condition is getting rather low. It may be down into the 50s after this next mission, so this may be the last time that we see Keith Alvarez for a little while. I'll probably switch him out to get some other wingmen in there. But for now, Alvarez is going to join me on this strike flight into North Vietnam. Okay, that's going to wrap up everything that we need to take a look at in this morning's briefing. We'll see you up on the flight deck as we kick the tires and light the fires and get blasted off into the sky. I'll see you up there. Here we are, locked up onto Catapult 1 on the flight deck. Flight controls are free and clear, good to go. Full power and full afterburner. Salute down to the shooting officer, stand by for launch. And Dallas 1 is airborne. Several hundred gallons of water used up from one plant down in the engineering spaces as that steam catapults us into the air for a standard VFR departure today. And gears up, flaps are up, leveling off at 500 feet above the waves. As I bring my radar online and set up my weapons for delivery over the target later, we're going to be heading 7 miles out from the ship before we make our turn to our departure course and climb up to cruise altitude. Now, since I don't have any sort of distance measuring equipment to the ship itself at the moment, I'm just going to estimate with times. At 450 knots, 7 miles is only going to take 1 minute to cross. So at 300 knots, it would be 1.5 minutes. You know, as we're coming up to speed, somewhere between a minute and a minute and a half. And that's going to be our 7 miles, and then we'll make our turn after that. There you go, and I'm looking down at the second hand on the clock, which is just to the right of the HSI there. And I think we probably took off about a minute ago, or a minute and a half ago, right about now. So 7 miles for sure, begin our climb and our turn to our departure heading. I know our assigned altitude was like, whatever it was, 58 or 6,800 feet again. I'm going to climb up to 25,000 feet, make our engines nice and efficient, and we'll have a very efficient run into the target. That's also going to keep us clear of any ground fire. On the other hand, it puts us directly onto the radar scopes of SAMs and possibly fighters. So that's something that we'll just have to be on the lookout for, but everything is a trade-off one way or another. Now, one thing that I am just realizing now that I kind of wish I had changed, but, you know, too late. We only have 2 Phantoms. The game auto-assigns smaller numbers of aircraft depending on the mission, so for whatever reason it decided that a strike only warrants 2 Phantoms. Now, the problem with that means that we're running at a reduced efficiency for our ECM. If you remember back to my lengthy discussion on ECM, the Phantom is equipped with the ALQ-51 Deception Jammer and Track Breaker. Now, the thing about that is that alone, an ALQ-51 is not very efficient at disrupting enemy radars, at confusing them with the deception jamming. But they found that a four-ship flight, four aircraft, in the, whatever you call it, the finger formation, provides wonderful protection. So by only taking two Phantoms, we've cut that ECM protection in half. So I'm kind of regretting that. Maybe I should have taken two more wingmen just to get the finger four formation for extensive ECM coverage. But too late now, we're already on our way. And hopefully, here's what I'm relying on. I'm gonna rely on altitude and speed to take us through the problem areas. And if we have to dodge SAMs, we'll have some altitude to hopefully do that. I'm also gonna rely on the fact that there will be several other friendly flights running interference through the Hanoi area, including interceptors. So we're just gonna have to keep an eye out for SAMs and fighters and dodge as necessary, and know that our ECM is not gonna be as efficient as it otherwise might have been. Now, as we continue climbing up to cruise altitude through this overcast cloud layer, I'd like to talk today about Yankee and Dixie stations. Yankee Station was a geographical point in the Gulf of Tonkin that was the deployment area for U.S. carrier fleets during the Vietnam War. The coordinates were officially designated Point Yankee, but was universally referred to as Yankee Station. The name comes from the letter Y in the phonetic alphabet, which is pronounced as Yankee. Point Yankee came into existence in 1964, when it was first used to launch reconnaissance flights over Laos, as part of the classified Operation Yankee Team. With the Laotian Civil War raging, and the U.S. sure that Laos, not Vietnam, would be the center of the fight against communism in Southeast Asia, the USS Kitty Hawk began launching medium and low-level recon missions into the Kingdom of Laos. These Yankee Team flights soon changed from pure recon into secret armed reconnaissance, and U.S. aircraft from both the Navy and Air Force began providing close air support for ground forces of the Royal Lao government. As the secret airstrikes against communist forces in Laos continued to ramp up, Operation Yankee Team was eventually morphed into Operation Barrel Roll. Yankee Station was originally located 120 miles due east of Da Nang in the South China Sea. With increased operations over North Vietnam in 1966, the point was moved 145 miles northwest into the Gulf of Tonkin. This is the location of Yankee Station that we see here in the game, and it's about 100 miles due north of Da Nang, with the Chinese island of Hainan only about 70 miles to the northeast. During the Rolling Thunder and Linebacker operations, there were normally three carriers on station. One flew operations from noon to midnight, another from midnight to noon, and the third during daylight hours. This gave 24-hour coverage of strike flights into Vietnam with additional effort during daylight. At one point in May of 1972, Yankee Station saw six carriers together on the line for a short time as they launched linebacker missions. Kitty Hawk was the first carrier on Yankee Station in 1964, and by the time of the Gulf of Tonkin incident had been joined by Ticonderoga and Constellation. USS Constellation would also be the last carrier on Yankee Station in August of 1973. To the south, a counterpart carrier station was established for flying missions into South Vietnam to fight the Viet Cong in the Mekong Delta. This point was called Dixie Station. The name was chosen to match Yankee Station, making a pun related to the traditional slang terms for the northern and southern halves of the United States. Yankee bombed the north, and Dixie bombed the south. Dixie was established in 1965, with a single carrier conducting close air support missions in the Delta. Carriers continued rotating into Dixie Station until August of 1966, when enough land-based aircraft had arrived in country to support ground operations and the Navy planes were no longer needed. Dixie Station was approximately 85 miles southeast of Cam Ranh Bay on the South Vietnam shore. No hits on our raw equipment yet, so nobody's painting us with radars just yet, but that may change at any moment. If you remember, RAW is a acronym for Radar Homing and Warning System, and that is what the radar warning receiver was called at the time. So instead of RWR, it was the RHAW, does the same job, just referred to in different nomenclature. The specific equipment for this aircraft is the APR-24, which is the C, S, and X band radar homing and warning system. This was installed on 4 or 5 aircraft for VF-96 on the Enterprise during this 66 to 67 cruise. This equipment was then removed after this cruise and replaced with upgraded equipment. All right, there's waypoint 3 making a left turn to waypoint 4, our initial point. We'll be feet dry over the Vietnam coast in just a few minutes. Wolfpack and Tuna flights are directly behind us and down below. Those are the Marine flights out of Da Nang. Tuna specifically is that escort flight of Phantom. So we've got escort Phantoms right in the area, hopefully protecting us against enemy fighters. And we've heard over the radios that there is air combat going on already somewhere, so the enemy is up. And SAMs are active as well. All right, we're about to be feet dry over the Vietnam coast. You can see that we're still ahead of the Tuna flight, which are the escorts, and the other F4 is behind us. So I'm going to throttle back, bring the engines back to 5,000 pounds per hour. I want to slow down to let the other guys catch back up with us so we're all together. I don't really want to be on point all alone coming into Vietnam here. You can see that there's an SA-2 site off to my right and to my left. So it's about 10 o'clock and 2 o'clock. And we've got enemy fighters at 10 miles dead ahead, and they're MiG-21 PFVs. We're at 25,000 feet. We're at about 325 knots. Nothing is showing up on the radar at the moment, so they may be really, really low. Because I'm cycling through, they should be well within the range of 25 miles, and nothing's showing up, so they're probably way beneath us. I'm not going to deviate from course just yet because of that, because I don't think they're... I don't think we're in danger just yet. And you can see Tuna Flight has spread out, so they're engaging something. Mamba's off to our right, so we're going to stay on target for the moment. Here we go, here's one of the Tuna Flight Marine F4s. They're climbing up through the clouds now, tracking some target. So maybe these MiG-21s are actually closer to my altitude than I thought, but we're just gonna hold tight for just a moment. Okay, Jarheads are firing missiles at enemy targets. That's very reassuring to see. There we go, there's a Sparrow off that Phantom. And I'm hearing Fox 2s for Sidewinders going out as well. So these guys are engaging these MiG-21s, which are very close now, off to my left. There we go, just off the left wing we've got Ensign Alvarez, and there's a Marine F4 coming right up next to us, engaging a target over the top of the canopy here. So these MiG-21s are danger close for sure. Ooh, lighting up the cans there. He's going after something. Look at him go. All right, back up to full military power. I think we just need to keep our speed up and get out of this area, which is slightly saturated with fighters. Take a look at our fuel gauge there. We are still on the drop tanks. We haven't even hit the internal fuel yet. Still at 13,000 and a half gallons, or pounds of fuel. We've got something off to our 9 o'clock high. Missile streaks going by. That might be a baddie. Yep, that was a MiG. Somebody, Tuna Flight, just bagged him. Look at that debris just falling down behind us. Contrails in the high altitude. And there we go, we're being pinged by a radar. Full afterburner. Those fan songs are picking us up. just over 360 knots now. More bandits, 11 o'clock, 25 miles, but they're low. They're down at 5,000. .400 knots. SAM launch! SAM launch! Banking hard. Looking for it. There's another one coming up at me. At least two missiles. Possibly more. So I'm searching, searching. I don't see anything yet. These fuckers are down below the clouds. There we go. I saw a streak in the mirror. One just passed by. Switching back the other way. S turning through the skies. Let's get back on target. Avoiding these other things coming up. I just saw a flash. It's either... Okay, no, it's flak up to my left. I was wondering if it was either flak or if a SAM detonated, but... More SAMs going against friendlies at this point. They are going nuts down there, those SA-2s. Another one at me! And another one at me! Holy hell! Fucking A. You know what? We're gonna fucking drop altitude. We're gonna point the nose at the ground as fast as we can, and if the missiles are tracking on us, they'll track ahead of our course and fly themselves into the ground. Look at that, coming out of the clouds. Vietnamese city right beneath us. I'm not sure what we're over at the moment. I'm a little disoriented. Two rivers, there's, Jesus Christ, there's air bases all over the place. Blacking out as I'm pulling back. Easing off just a little bit to come back into the real world. Okay, and we've lost the lock now. Thank Christ. Flak and tracers heading up above us. I'm afraid that's Alvarez taking the brunt of enemy fire. Hopefully he's going to get through it unscathed. I think this is Thud Ridge right in front of us here, Tam Dao Mountains. We are down low now. We're definitely off the tanks. Fuel tanks jettisoned. We're on the internals. We have just over 10,000 pounds of fuel left. I'm on target. Fuck it, we're going to climb back up now that we've avoided those SAMs. Because I want to get back to 25,000 for our dive bombing run. SAM incoming on Alvarez. Alvarez, break. Okay, hitting 20,000 feet as we zoom climb back up to cruise altitude. Just under 10,000 pounds fuel. Still have plenty to work with. If we have to keep dodging SAMs, I'm okay with that. Just kissing 23,000 feet now. Okay, Alvarez, still with me, fully loaded. He didn't dump any ordnance for the break, so that's good. In fact, he still has his drop tank on him, which is interesting. Okay, our wild, crazy maneuvering has gotten us off of the fansong screens for the second, so things are quiet for the moment. We're just a few miles away from our initial point. Creeping back up to 25,000 feet. Oh, 9,500 pounds of fuel, 350 knots, and we're just passing over Thud Ridge, which is down below us, just off to the left, underneath the cloud cover. We're 6 miles away from the initial point. Close enough to the target now. Selecting my 500-pound bombs, which have been rigged up to salvo off the aircraft. You can see my gun sight pipper depressed, having selected air to ground. .2 miles from the initial point, 350 knots. Alvarez should be... There he is, I see Alvarez in the mirrors. He's coming up behind me. Okay, we just hit the initial point, so beginning our left turn We're going to line up the target. Now, I've made up a little chart for myself, doing some math that I'm going to experiment on this mission and see how it works out. For a 50-degree nose-down dive-bombing attitude, depending on what my altitude is starting at, I should be able to math out how far away from the target I should nose over. So for 25,000 feet, should be right at 5 miles on the DME. DME is not distance to the target, it's not a straight line distance, it's the distance to the waypoint. So, slight difference, but at 5 miles, I'm going to nose over to my 50 degree down and hopefully pop out right on target. We'll see how that goes. It's slightly different than the procedure I was using before that I just made up through trial and error. This one's going to be a little more based in math, and we'll see if that's better or worse or the same. And picking up a ground radar. Although, Red Crown says no fighters in the area. So that's a plus. Let's get Alvarez back on my wing. I'm going to tell him to attack my target just as I'm nosing over. So we're at 6 miles now. 1 mile to go. Let's get right on the nose, 25,000 feet. Dallas 2, attack my target. We're at 5 miles out, cutting the throttle, nosing over. Air brakes out. Looking at that gyro. Is that 50 degrees? Why am I suddenly confused? This is not a good time to be confused. Okay, it looks about 50 degrees. We're going down through the cloud cover. And I've got a salmon coming. As we're coming up a little short, there it is, off to my left, 9 o'clock, streaking up towards me. Jesus Christ. All right, Pipper right on that bridge now. We're just underneath 500 knots. Lost the lock because it just went right behind me. There's Alvarez right in front of me. Bombs away. Yes. Alvarez, reform. Picking up some flak and some tracers as we are coming down, in addition to that SAM site, which is right over here to my left somewhere. We're kind of turning into it at this point. Trying to see over the wing back of it. There it is, there's the target. In ruins. Smoke coming up everywhere. Okay, back to the right for our egress route. Let's get the fuck out of here. Coming around to course. Fansong picking us up on radar again. Deselecting all weapons. Probably jinking a little bit. There we go, there's the remains of the bridge. We can actually see it really well now. We dropped that sucker. That was such a cool picture on the way in. Alvarez just right in front of us in the one F4 and then us behind, and then we just laid into that bridge with our 500-pound bombs. Little village over here. Oh, SAM inbound! Probably from that same site to my left. Can't see shit, though. Where is it? There it goes, as I turn towards the ground. Okay, back towards the course, I saw it fly by harmlessly behind me. There it goes, streaking off into the hills. Jesus Christ, a lot of SAMs today. What is it? It's like 6 or 7 SAMs just at me. One at the wingman, one at Alvarez, and a ton at the other F4 flights. All right, Alvarez. He's no damage. He's doing good. No enemy fighters to go after this time out, though. Looks like the Marines took care of everything. I just want to climb back up to altitude and egress out of the country. Here we go. Here's the remains of the Futo Bridge that we just decimated with bombs. It should be noted that in the game, it's pretty easy to destroy these bridges with freefall dumb bombs, with just the iron bombs. In real life, that was one of the biggest pains in the asses for both the Navy and the Air Force, was knocking down these Vietnamese bridges, and they had all sorts of problems. Bombs were not accurate enough to do enough damage to put them out of commission permanently, and there was clusters of anti-aircraft fire that surrounded them, so every bridge mission was extremely dangerous and resulted in many losses. And then, really, the hallmark of the linebacker operations later in the 70s is that's when the really high-tech stuff started showing up, so the laser-guided bombs were put to good effect, taking out bridges for the first time. But here in Rolling Thunder, when we would have just been using either iron bombs or even the bullpup missiles, you know, the bullpup, the pilot-guided air-to-ground missiles, those were designed to take out bridges, but they were not effective against these Vietnamese bridges because they were so strongly built. The warhead on the bullpups was not big enough to do enough damage, and the dumb bombs, the iron bombs, weren't accurate enough to put enough of them on target to knock them down. So, in the game, they're actually pretty easy to knock out, which is not realistic in that sense, but what can you do? So heading back out of the target area here, my little chart did not work. We nosed over, and then when I popped out of the clouds, I was way short of the target. So I think on the one hand, it may work better. Well, I'm going to try it more in the future. But I definitely was pretty slow. I was only above 300 knots when I nosed over, and then I put the air brakes out. So I think letting the aircraft come up to speed of around 500 knots and then putting the air brakes out is probably going to be the way to go. That would maybe put the Pipper on target. Either way, once we corrected, I mean, the bomb still fell exactly where the Pipper was, so I don't know, it's not that big of a deal. Plus, we had the added help of Alvarez. We had the two F-4s dropping their bombs right on the same target at the same time. And I'll be interested to see in the debriefing which one of us actually got the kill on that bridge. Just heading home over the gray plain at the moment, that overcast layer way below us. The raw is quiet again. Okay, so I want Alvarez I really want him to join up with me. I was talking on the way in how the ECM is not effective in a single aircraft, and we're already at a reduced strength because there's only two of us, so now Alvarez is lagging way behind, so the both of us are more at risk to be targeted by a SAM because we're not reinforcing each other's ECM. So I really want him to get his ass up here because, look, we're still way over Vietnam. In fact, off to my 11 o'clock, there's an SA-2 and a fan song on the banks of that river. So, Alvarez, buddy, you gotta get up here. We need to at least combine our two ECMs together to make it a little bit harder, because we're not out of the woods yet. We may have more SAMs up our ass. Yep, look at that. Speak of the devil. That fan song picking us up. 11 or 10 o'clock low at this point. Dumping the air brakes, just slowing the plane way down so that Alvarez catches up faster. Well, we're picking up flak. That fan song sending our coordinates to the radar-guided AAA guns as well as the SAMs. Alvarez still has bombs on board. That's interesting. He didn't dump the whole load on the bridge. I'm surprised by that. God, I'm less than 300 knots, and he's not he's like throttling back to stay back there. What do you catch up to me, guy? All right. I'm going to put a little bit of bank in, one to confuse the AAA gunners, and two to maybe force Alvarez to catch up to me. Come on, man. Get in formation. Sam inbound, son of a fucking bitch, as predicted. Down there, 10 or 11 o'clock low, coming up through the clouds. We've got 6 seconds of unguided flight, and then after that it's going to start tracking. So that's about long enough. We're going to start pulling and maneuvering, try to start spoiling its tracking, wherever it is. I can't see it. It's probably going to be shooting up pretty soon, though, so I'm going to keep an eye out. S turning back. I want to keep heading towards the ocean. Still can't see it. Where the fuck is this thing? I am really sick of getting Sam shot at me today. Let me tell you. Okay, cutting back the other way now, keeping the S-turns moving. There's Alvarez in front of me, finally caught up. Cutting back and forth, still heading towards the ocean. Don't want to do circles over the Sam site. That's going to be no good. There we go, waypoint 7 has been reached. So that is the coast of Vietnam. We are feet wet. And we lost the SAM lock. Finally, I never saw that thing. Hey Alvarez, get your ass up here into formation. Not fucking kidding, man. So I never saw that missile. Never saw it. It zoomed by at some point. How did he get way back here again? He was in front of me a second ago. Jesus Christ. If I tell him to return home to base, he'll dump all that ordnance and then maybe go faster, but then... Well, no, who cares? Like, he just crossed feet wet, too. So, he's probably going to be out of range of the SAM site as well. We are 47 miles away from our next waypoint. And we'll level off 25,000 feet and we'll set cruise speed for the trip back to the fleet at Yankee Station. 350 knots as I hit the wing leveler. Here we go, here's a Wild Weasel F-105, still doing work out over the coast. This is possibly Tan Hoa, city of Tan Hoa. And for some reason he feels the need to keep attacking ground anti-air units. Looks like it's rolling in on something.
Fire and gun.
Yep.
Target hit.
Well, he's still getting the job done. That's one brave SOB. Four miles out from the next waypoint. Probably going to start dropping at 20. We'll make a descent down through the clouds. And you can see when we hit that last waypoint, it's just a right turn to line up with the ship.
We're coming under attack. Request assistance.
Dodge one. Hawkeye, copy that.
Sam inbound.
This F-105 flying right over the large sphere of an early warning radar. The early warning radars were the part of the network that would pick up the American flights on their way in, and then they would either guide fighters to intercept, or they would hand them over to local Fansongs and SAM sites to take over to fire missiles at. Down through the clouds now. And back out on the underside. ECM is off. We don't need that on anymore. No point in running that. There we go. Waypoint 8 is reached. 10 miles from waypoint 9. So I'm just going to continue this steep descent down to 1,000 feet and set up for our initial point for landing. ...1,500 feet above the waves now. You can see all the Navy flights are making their way back to their respective ships. Looks like we're the only ones coming back to Enterprise at the moment, so the airspace should be clear. No risk of, hitting anybody else over the ship. But, just in case, I put the radar on 10 miles anyways. With the radar at short range, we'll be able to see anything in the airspace ahead of us that might be a collision hazard.
Dallas, call the ball.
All right, we just hit the initial point. Looks like Alvarez is on his own, setting up for his approach and landing. So we're just going to make our pass on our own here. Hook is down and locked. Bringing the speed down to around between 350 and 400 knots for the brake. I don't want to be going too fast. And we're right at 1,000 feet, pulling parallel with the Enterprise for the flyby. Alright, I think we're going to pass right over the top of her. We're not going to see her, so we'll just watch the nav needle swing around. There we go, we just passed over. She's astern of us now, and then at 1 mile, we'll hit the brake. There we go, 1 mile. Dallas 1 is in the brake. Under 200 knots now. Tootsies are out, flaps are down, hook is down and locked. We're right at 1,000 feet, rolling out on downwind. There we go, I've got the ship visually. Just coming abeam of the touchdown point. 150 knots as we begin our turn to base and final. So I'm going to add just a touch of power. I don't need any accelerated stalls in a turn at low altitude with this aircraft. AOA indexer is actually showing that we're spot on for once, which is nice. I guess that's because I'm actually slow enough. I'm at the correct approach speed. Clearing off to the right, I don't see the wingman. I think we're clear. ...165 knots as we're coming around, lining up on centerline. And a bit of stall buffet for the first time, rolling out. And here we go. Touchdown, and a good trap! Right on centerline, for the most part. Okay, Alvarez is right on my ass coming in, so folding up and taxiing clear of the landing zone. Alright, looks good. We're clear of the landing zone. Plenty of space for Alvarez right behind me. And we're gonna park it here. As I shut the engines down and open up the canopy, we'll see you down below in the debriefing room in just a few minutes. And we'll see who actually got the credit for hitting that bridge. I'm interested to see. Alright, we'll see you down there. Welcome to the debriefing. Both Alvarez and I back safely aboard the Enterprise after a pretty harrowing mission. And what's that Winston Churchill quote about there being no greater exhilaration in life than being shot at with no effect? Something like that. I'm paraphrasing that. But yeah, that's definitely this mission. Okay, so our objective was to strike a strategic target located in Futuh. We destroyed the enemy highway bridge in the target area. Flight time was 50 minutes, 24 seconds. Primary target was destroyed. 1F4 was damaged. I'm actually not sure which one of us that was. Might have been Alvarez. He was a lot closer to the ground when those bombs went off. I wonder if he took collateral damage from the explosions. Rating, outstanding success. Score of 2,500. So, over to the stats. I fired 18 bombs for one hit and one kill. Looks like I got the kill on the bridge with one hit. Ensign Alvarez, though he didn't fire all of his bombs in the diving run for some reason, he did drop four bombs, all four of which hit right on target, 100% hit percentage, but he didn't get the kill. So, it's possible then that his four 500-pound bombs struck the target and weakened it enough that my one that hit finished the job and dropped it down. So, team effort there, I guess. So we know that I'm the one that got the credit for dropping the bridge because Alvarez didn't get any kills, he just got hits. But I do want to look at the log and just count how many SAMs were fired this mission at us, because it was a lot. This is more SAMs than we have seen in any other mission so far in these campaigns. So, 7:06 in the morning, I had an SA-2 Charlie fire at me and a Bravo within seconds of each other. So two SAMs coming up at me. This is when we were transiting over Hanoi, I think. And then within 30 seconds or so, 30 or 40 seconds later, those same two sites launched another two. So I had four SAMs coming up at me at the time. So that must have been when I nosed over at the ground and dove for Jesus, because now here we at 7:08, we've got all these S-60s firing AAA at me. So that was all the flak and tracers coming up. Within about 20 seconds of that, SA-2 Charlie launches at Ensign Alvarez. That must have been when we were pulling out and we looked up and saw Alvarez going above. He was catching all that flak and tracers, so Sam must have tried to get him at the same time too. So a few minutes went by, which is when I climbed back up to altitude, made the turn around Thud Ridge, and then just as I was diving on the target, SA-2 Bravo fires at me at 7:13. I was already in the dive for the bomb run, and just kind of didn't look at that one, and it passed right behind me and lost the lock. So, 20 seconds, less than 20 seconds after that, Ensign Alvarez is dropping his bombs, then I drop my bombs. Let's see, Ensign Alvarez hit the highway bridge with the 500-pound bombs. In fact, he hit it 4 times. And then I came along, and I just laid down my usual long line of bombs. I don't cluster them for some reason. Maybe I'll try that next time. I'll do a nice concentrated cluster of bombs instead of stringing them out. But, you know, my thing is to string them out. In case I miss, you've got a long line of bombs. Something's going to do the job, you know? And then about 40, 45 seconds later, we had that SA-2 sight fire at me again as we were egressing. And then several minutes after that was that final SA-2 as we were trying to cross over the coastline. So let's do the math here real quick. 4 SAMs in the beginning, 2 more at us for 6, and then 2 at the end for 8. So we had 8 SAMs launched at just these 2 F-4s in this mission. That's not counting whatever they were firing at everybody else. So the air was thick with surface-to-air missiles today. Okay, that's going to do it for today. Nothing else to no awards or anything. So we're going to call that the end of this episode. Thank you so much for coming along with me on this one. I hope you liked it, as usual. And I hope to see you once again for more flying and fighting over Vietnam. We'll see you then.